across the Far North Coast Presbytery, we acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land and the waters. We pay respect to the elders past, present, and emerging. We honour and give thanks for their deep spirituality and faith.
I warmly welcome you to this, the first of the Far North Coast Presbytery's online services. Tomorrow is the 43rd anniversary of the inauguration of the Uniting Church in Australia. And in this service today, we celebrate our anniversary. The candle reminds us of the light of Christ that shines in the world. But also the candle, the light of the candle, reminds us of the love of Christ that touches us in every place and in every time.
We gather together today online in this strange way, in a strange time, yet together in unity and love. The combined uniting churches of the Far North Coast Presbytery, from Grafton in the south to the Tweed in the north, from the Pacific coast along the rivers, across the plains and plateaus to west of the ranges. Friends, families and visitors from far and wide. We are different people. We come from different places. We have journeyed on different pathways, yet we gather today in unity, united together in the name of Jesus Christ, one body, one faith, one Lord. And in words spoken 43 years ago, in the call to worship at the inauguration service of the Uniting Church in Australia. How good and joyful a thing it is to dwell in unity. Our help is in the name of the Lord who has made heaven and earth. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. And so here in this time we gather. Here in this time we join in the song of all creation. May our hearts be open to hearing God's voice, and may our lives be transformed by the Holy Spirit as we worship together in unity. Let us worship God.
Magic.
warmest greetings from the Far North Coast Presbytery to each of you who gather today in this time of worship. Through the unifying grace of the Holy Spirit, across the Far North Coast, we are drawn together with a common purpose of worshipping, loving, and serving our Lord Jesus Christ, and sharing our faith in our lives and in our communities. During the coronavirus pandemic, I have been heartened by the way in which people have cooperated and the mutual support that's been expressed between congregations and the presbytery, between ministry agents in the presbytery, and within congregations. We are thankful for the creativity and goodwill that has enabled us to worship and to care for each other, even when we have not been able to gather together face to face in the last months. Our thanks go to the ministry agents and to the moderator and to some of our lay leaders who have participated in this service. A special thanks to Greer and Phil Dokmanovich for their organisation and editing of this service. Our Lord Jesus Christ has been with us and will continue to be with us as we move into the next phase of our life as a church during the coronavirus pandemic. That time when we move and feel our way back to gathering again in the midst of health restrictions. May God bless you all.
It's great to be with you in worship again on this, the anniversary of the Uniting Church, 43 years this year since we formed ourselves and found our way into the world. We've always sought to be a movement, a pilgrim people, rather than an institution. We marked ourselves as different from the other churches in the sense that we don't have somebody at the head and folk just following and doing what they're told. We have a series of councils that work together. It's an ideal about how we understand ourselves. People together seeking to hear God's voice. It's a challenge because lots of voices speaking sometimes can make God's voice hard to hear. Chesterton once said, "The Christian ideal hasn't been tried and found wanting. It's been found too difficult and left untried." The Uniting Church has struggled and achieved and celebrated and succeeded and sometimes failed to be the church we believe we're called to be, that God calls us to be. As we find our way in faith in the world, there will be times when everything falls into place wonderfully, and there'll be times when things are really difficult, almost beyond our reach. We're a church that believes that God will keep reforming us and changing us and challenging us, that we haven't always got it right. In fact, sometimes we feel the whole thing might be on the edge of not being right at all. That's how we listen for God's voice, repenting and turning around and hearing what God is saying to us again. We live in a world which is changing all the time. This COVID-19 challenge before us has moved us from the past into a new place which is moving around even as we speak, and there'll be a new place again fairly soon. We must listen for God's voice, seek God's face, and often we'll hear that voice and see the face in places we least expect. May God bless you for this journey, for your celebration. May God bless you to hear God's voice and see God's face in the most surprising and wonderful places. And may you know that God's Spirit is calling you not just for this day, but for every day. And not just into eternal life, that's wonderful, but into the life to which God calls you here and now. Amen.
May the peace of Christ follow you wherever you go, at home, at work, in the world. May the peace of Christ be always with you.
May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace of the Lord be with you all.
The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
Peace be with you.
Que la paz de Dios sea contigo.
The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is the Reverend Robert Buchan. My wife Thea and I are working for Lismore Churches, the seven churches of the Lismore Regional Mission. But we're working from here on the south coast, 1,000 kilometres distant. Today, we're going to talk about the Uniting Church and the birthday of the Uniting Church, but particularly, we're going to talk about the logo or sign of the Uniting Church. And here is our logo. Logo is an interesting word because it comes from the Greek logos, which means word. And indeed, as a symbol, it tells many stories in many words. That's what symbols or logos do. There are lots of other symbols or logos that we could talk about. And one of the most common ones is that of the Olympic rings. And here they are. Five rings that are interlinked. And the five rings represent the five major regions of the world: Africa, the Americas, Asia, Europe, and Oceania, which includes Australia. Every national flag in the world includes at least one of these five colours, which are blue, yellow, black, green, or red. So the people of the world are all linked together in the Olympic Games. What about an hourglass then? An hourglass tells us the time. But for many, it represents time itself, that time keeps marching on. What about the cross? And what about the fish? Symbols that are very much linked with our faith. The cross, of course, tells us not only about Christ's sacrifice, but Christ's love. The fish, of course, is an early symbol of the church as well. But let's look at our logo, the logo that hundreds of churches stretching right across Australia use. It's a very rich logo or symbol indeed, for it's made up of many parts. Let's now head into our study and look at the different parts that make up the Uniting Church logo. Our logo starts off with a black circle for the background. It shows our world, our planet that's dark at night. But dark also because there are still many places where Christ's light has not yet reached. Next, we add the white U. What might that mean? U for uniting. Perhaps it's part of a circle that's not yet complete. It might mean a smile. Next, we add another white piece. What do you see now? A boat? Perhaps an anchor? We add another piece. You might see the cross of Christ. You might see a sailboat sailing on a darkened world, and a place of safety in that boat for you and me. You might see an anchor with arms to keep it balanced. And what's this? A bird? A dove? Flying, not resting. A dove is often our symbol for the Holy Spirit, as well as a sign of peace and hope. It could be a flame, flame red like Pentecost. Yes, it is, all of these things and more. The man who designed this for the Uniting Church was Mr. Jim Gibson. He won a competition to design a logo for the new Uniting Church when it formed in 1977, and here's what he said about his design. The three colours symbolise the three church denominations that form the Uniting Church, the Methodists, the Presbyterians, and the Congregationalists. The design shows the light of the cross over the darkened world. The U stands for the Uniting Church, but also helps to form an anchor or a boat, both symbols of the first church. The red dove shows the moving of Christ's Spirit, flying over us and bringing the church to life. Each of us might see different things at different times in the Uniting Church logo. But we remember these wonderful words from Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, that are read around the churches around the world today. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Let's pray. Lord, may your Logos, your eternal word, always be on our hearts, our mind, our souls, and the lips of each of us, your precious children. Protect, guide, and nurture us all, we pray. In Jesus' name, Amen.
We I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the Lord's house." And now we are here, standing inside the gates of Jerusalem. Jerusalem is a city restored to beautiful order and harmony. This is where the tribes come, the tribes of Israel, to give thanks to the Lord according to his command. Here the kings of Israel sat to judge their people. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you prosper. May there be peace inside your walls and safety in your palaces. For the sake of my relatives and friends, I say to Jerusalem, peace be with you. For the sake of the houses of the Lord our God, I pray for your prosperity. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I love the theatre. As a student both at school and university, I studied as much theatre and drama as I could. And of course, this meant that I studied a fair amount of William Shakespeare and his many plays. So as you can imagine, I was quite excited when we were planning on going to London for the very first time, because it meant that I could go to the Globe Theatre. Not the original Shakespeare Globe Theatre, of course, that burnt down some years ago, but a replica created to be as close as possible to the original theatre where Shakespeare's plays were performed. They performed modern interpretations as well as traditional style of Shakespearean plays on this stage. And they have a museum there with historical and theatrical artifacts. Just heaven to me. So we headed to London. We bought our tickets to the Globe Theatre and we stood there in the pit with the other groundlings looking up at the enormous stage. People shuffled in all around us, the open air above us, and thankfully no rain. Rain would certainly have made the experience more difficult to endure. We were blessed with good weather and we were blessed with a fabulous performance of King Lear. It was so great. I mean, most of it was fantastic. There were some bits I didn't quite understand. It is Shakespeare after all, and King Lear isn't necessarily one of my favourites. There were some bits where the romance of standing on your feet for hours on end watching a performance grew a little tiresome. But looking back now, what I remember is the joy of being there. I was so delighted, so grateful to be there. I'd been looking forward to it since I first learned that such a theatre even existed years before. And then I got to go and stand there in that place with all the electric energy and history and wonder and possibility. It made me feel alive. The psalm we have just heard read for us, Psalm 122, is a song written by David and sung by pilgrims as they travelled to Jerusalem. It tells of this same kind of excitement and anticipation of preparing to go somewhere, and then the joy of arriving, of being there in this much anticipated and hoped for place and experience. The joy of travelling to Jerusalem, this place of pilgrimage where the temple of God stood, this holy city where followers of God went to worship. Today, as we recall the birth of the Uniting Church in Australia, it makes me wonder if this excitement and anticipation, this same joy and wonder, was much like what was experienced by the founders of the Uniting Church here in Australia, as they experienced the birth of a new denomination, a new church in Australia, a new way of being God's people in the world. I confess, when the Uniting Church was formed, I wasn't yet born. June 1977 was 18 months shy of my birth, and apologies if that makes you feel old. But I wish I could have been there. I can only imagine the excitement, the anticipation of becoming. Much like the gladness of going to Jerusalem that's expressed in this psalm, with this heartfelt desire, let us go. This is somewhere we long to go. This is about becoming a people we long to be. This psalm captures not only the excitement of anticipating going, but the joy and thrill of arriving. Here we are. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the Lord's house." And now we are here, standing inside the gates of Jerusalem. We are here. We have arrived in this longed-for place. I wonder, friends, have we arrived as a church yet? Have the dreams of our founders been fully realized yet? Or are we still on our way, anticipating and hoping? How might we continue to dream this incredible dream and realize this revolutionary vision of continuing to become the Uniting Church in Australia? How might we continue to capture a sense of wonder, the same sense of wonder that brought three separate denominations and together as one, this church that found a new way of having unity in diversity? Maybe we might be inspired to go and find a copy of The Basis of Union and read it again, or maybe for the first time, to read it and to remember and find some renewed anticipation of what God is still growing in us as God's people. So I want to invite us today, as we remember, as we look back to what has been, as we look around to what is, and as we look ahead to what might be, may we invite some wonder and anticipation, some excitement. So in this moment now, I invite us to be still. I invite us to pause. You might like to close your eyes or just soften your gaze. I invite us to give thanks. Let us bring our awareness to the earth's foundation beneath us, all that is solid beneath our feet. May we give thanks for Christ, the center and foundation of this church. May we give thanks for the founders who worked over many years to create the Uniting Church in Australia, to frame the basis of union and to dare to dream of new ways of being. I invite us to be aware of the air around our bodies, touching our skin, moving in currents unseen, traveling in and out of our bodies. May we give thanks for the presence of the Spirit, who has moved and continues to move in and through us as a pilgrim people on the way. And I invite us to call to mind our collective memory of our experiences of the Uniting Church throughout the last 43 years. What are the memories, the experiences, the knowing, that you hold in your mind. I invite you to call to mind that which you love about this, our shared church. Perhaps the values we hold, the things we stand for and give voice to, perhaps the traditions that have nourished us, perhaps the worship, witness, and service of individuals and communities with whom you have journeyed, within congregations, presbyteries, synods, and across the assembly. May we give thanks for the beauty, the wonder, and the joy of being a part of this family, the Uniting Church in Australia. And lastly, I invite us into our hearts to be aware of and to hold tenderly our hopes for the Uniting Church, our dreams for who we are and who we could be as we continue our journey, our pilgrimage, our growing. May we let ourselves dream, let ourselves hope, let ourselves anticipate with excitement and wonder and gladness. May we continue to respond to God's love. May we be renewed. May we have courage. And may we be blessed with the peace of God which transcends all understanding. Amen.
In this week of the birthday of the Uniting Church in Australia, let us confess those sins that can divide and sometimes alienate us from the unity in Christ. Please join in prayer saying, "Rebuke and forgive us, loving Savior." Let us pray. If we have honored the particular emphasis of our branch of the church more than the health of the one holy universal church, rebuke and forgive us, loving Savior. If we have been jealous of denominations that seem stronger than ours, or if we have despised those that appear weaker, rebuke and forgive us, loving Savior. If in our dealings with secular friends, we have by word or deed designated other churches or damned them with faint praise, rebuke and forgive us, loving Savior. If we have treasured the things that divide us more than the priceless pearl of gospel that we hold in common trust, rebuke and forgive us, loving Savior. If we have been eager to lecture others but slow to listen and prone to use them to our advantage rather than serving them, rebuke and forgive us, loving Savior. If we have placed any item of churchly creed or practice above the command to love one another as Christ has loved us, rebuke and forgive us, loving Savior. God of remarkable patience and inexhaustible resourcefulness, please continue to have mercy on us and on all your church. Forgive our denominational sins and those of each individual member. Restore us to a humble faith and to the vigorous pursuit of the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. By the grace of Christ, you are forgiven people. May God make us hold to live as a forgiven, redeemed, and enlightened people. Let us say, thanks be to God.
My heart, let me be as good. Jesus is praying for his disciples. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may become completely one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that those also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory, which you have given me because you love me, for the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. Amen.
Hello, wonderful people from the far North Coast Presbytery. My name is Pablo Nunez, and I have the privilege of being the minister at Ballina Uniting Church, where I'm speaking to you today from what usually is sunny Ballina, not quite the case, but what a privilege and what an honor it is to be able to connect with all of you through this way. And I hope that you have, as ministers, this great sense of honor, great sense of privilege that it is to participate together and to share together this morning. I've been asked to share with you from the reading from John 17, and what a beautiful, beautiful chapter that is. Everything that comes from that prayer, that deep, incredible, significant, relevant, life-changing prayer of Jesus in John chapter 17. They say that when somebody is close to death, when they realize that they are living the last days, the last hours, everything that is not essential, anything that is superficial is put aside, and only the essential, the most important things remain. And having shared those hours, being at the room with people close to passing, I can testify that this has been also my experience. We don't talk about the things that are on the side. We don't talk about our football teams. We don't talk about our favorite recipes. We don't talk about anything like that. The conversations are about life, death, family, what remains, what will happen next. The most important things is what we focus on those moments. And Jesus is living such a time. He knows that in just a few hours he will be taken. He knows that he will be tortured and crucified. He knows that his death is fast approaching. And this is one of these moments that he has the possibility of bringing a prayer. Bringing into prayer, bringing into the presence of God in a special way, bringing into this intimate moment in which we connect with God, the most important things to pray for. He starts that time praying for himself. Then he prays for his disciples, those who are there present with him, the ones who have been walking with him for about 3 years, the ones who will carry on with his ministry, with his incredible work. He knows that it will be a hard time for them. He knows that things are not going to be easy or simple. So he prays for them in an extended way. And then he prays for us. Then he prays for those who will come to believe. Because he knows that this wave is unstoppable. He knows that the message of the cross, the gospel, will be taken forward by the disciples and is spread throughout the world and will be spread throughout time, reaching even to us today. He knows that this wave will start touching people and transforming places, transforming societies, transforming nations, moving to from Jerusalem to the ends of the earth. And he was praying for you and me. He was praying for us in this distant land, almost 2,000 years apart in time. He will pray for us. Pray that we will be one. Pray that we will come to a place of unity so people will believe in this message. He knows that this gospel that comes from one culture, from one place on earth, is going to move forward and touch different people in different places with different backgrounds, with different stories, different languages, different ways to understand, different ways to see the world. And what he prays for us is unity. That we will be one, even as, like the prophet said, we may be one, but we are not the same, and we're never going to be the same. And yet, with our differences, with our diversity, with the many different ways in which we see and we feel the world, we can be one. The world over the last few weeks has been impacted by the power of our differences, the depth of our brokenness. And it's in those moments that we have to remember once again that this call to be one is essential. That if you and I can walk on each other's shoes and see life from a different perspective, we can come. And even with everything that is different between us, we can come and find unity in Christ. We can start dreaming about a real change, a real transformation to this world. And please let me finish this quick reflection by saying this. As in the mind of Christ wasn't just that moment in that prayer, as beautiful as it is. A few hours later, as Jesus is on the cross, he speaks once again those words from Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? And for some, that is a declaration of pain, a separation, of distress, but for me, that's the beginning of a song of victory, because Psalm 22 is a song of victory. It's a song that declares all the things that will happen as the Messiah is on the cross, but this is how it ends. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. And verse 30, posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to a people yet unborn, he has done it. So once again, in the mind of Christ, in his thoughts, this song of victory that starts with distress and separation and pain, but finishes with this powerful declaration that all the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, that we, the future generations, will receive this message and we will take it forward. There's no better way to celebrate the beautiful, beautiful heritage that we have as the Uniting Church, not just from this last 43 years, but from our traditions, from the roots of our Presbyterian or Methodist or congregational traditions. There's no better way to celebrate our heritage than to build a powerful, living, transforming legacy. So as we look back today, we celebrate. As we look back, we honor those who have come before us. We honor those who have built this church in the power of the Holy Spirit. And we celebrate that we have come to this place of unity that is not done yet. This message has to be spread, has to be shared, has to be once again passed forward. So my privilege is to celebrate the beautiful heritage that I have received. The challenge ahead is to continue to build this legacy, to honor Jesus, to honor the message that has come to us, and to honor all those lives that it's because of them that we are here today. So may you move forward in unity. May you move forward knowing that they have this powerful past just giving you all this momentum to go forward. May you know that you are not alone in your faith and in your fight, in your struggle, in your victories. And may you know that we are building on a powerful, powerful, powerful history, because this wave won't stop. The next chapter is just before us. So let's take it. Let's take this opportunity to continue to build on that amazing prayer of Jesus. His words have come before us, are with us, and will go ahead of us. Let's go, because this dream of God is far, far, far from over. And you and I, we have our place. We have a part on it, and what a privilege it is. So may you be blessed, knowing that you were in the words, in the prayer, in the mind, in the heart of Christ, as he prayed for us, as he was on the cross, as you are in his heart and in his mind right now. Blessings to all. Grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Peace of the Lord be with you all. Let's pray as we would to the Father. Almighty God, as we come before you today, we come with thoughts that tomorrow will be the anniversary of the Uniting Church in its 40 odd years. We give thanks that three different traditions were wanting to come together and be united. For Lord, you call us to be one in heart and in mind. And Lord, we were trying to obey this, and yet there is still division. So we pray for healing processes to heal the divisions within the church, our church. We pray too, Lord, that the divisions that exist between all the different traditions may be taken away, and that you would bring your universal church together in a wonderful way so that it becomes a real witness to the world. And Lord, as we pray for your church, we think of those in parts of the world where the church is under persecution. in places like Pakistan and China. And we just pray that that persecution may cease. But then, Lord, we know that when we read the Bible, that people gave thanks for the persecution because it was as you were persecuted, Lord Jesus. And they thought that to be able to suffer in the same way was an honor. But we pray for peace for them in our times. And Lord, as we continue to pray, we think of this time in the world with this coronavirus and its devastating effects upon the lives of people and countries and the terrible death toll. We give thanks for our country, where the Prime Minister and the other ministers in the National Cabinet have made decisions that have enabled us to avoid the worst of what could have been. And so we give thanks for that protection through the wisdom that has been you've bestowed upon our leaders. We pray that that wisdom may continue as the restrictions are lifted, and that we, Lord, would be careful, but always walk in the Spirit with you. And Lord, as we pray for that too, we pray for our families and our loved ones, wherever they may be, in this country or in the world, you know, across the nations. Keep them safe. Bless them, Lord, and protect them. That may sound selfish, Lord, but they are our people. But we do pray that there be a vaccine found and a control of the virus made, that people's lives can return to normal across the world. And Lord, as we pray for them, we pray again for our national leaders and the heads of our church, that you would be with each one of them, bless them with wisdom and understanding, so that they may walk in your ways through the days of their lives and lead us as we should be led. These things we pray in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Before Christianity was rich and powerful, before it was associated with buildings, budgets, crusades, colonization, or tele-evangelism, it began as a revolutionary, non-violent movement, promoting a new kind of aliveness on the margins of society, says Brian McLaren. It dared to honour women, children, unmarried adults, in a world ruled by married men. It dared to elevate slaves to equality with those who gave them orders. It challenged slave masters to free their slaves and to see them as peers. It defied religious taboos that divides people into us and them, good and evil, clean and unclean. It claimed that everyone, not just an elite few, had God-given gifts to be used for the common good. Before Christianity was a rich and powerful religion, it was a religion of peace, a love movement, a joy movement, a justice movement, an integrity movement, an aliveness movement. As we come out of social isolation, and Jesus is waiting on the shores of Galilee, calling us, come and follow me. The revolutionary movement of love continues as we journey back to our buildings. The sacrament of Holy Communion is central to us as a people of God. Where I come from in the Salvation Army, the whole hour of worship is a sacrament. Where do you come from? What's life been like for you over the past few months? What symbols would you bring, like bread and wine, in your home? Pointing to love so amazing, pointing to amazing grace, pointing to community, pointing to a call to worship, witness, and serve. So here, as the waters lap the bank, as you sit in your homes, from the south to the north to the west of our presbytery, we go back to the night when Jesus was betrayed and took bread and broke it. Then after supper, the love feast continued. And he took wine, real wine actually, not grape juice, and blessed it and shared it among his friends, those that would betray him, those that would deny him three times. He sent them off to be his followers. So we pick up our backpacks and we take a look at what's in them. We discard what we don't need. We keep what's important, and maybe we embrace the new for the journey ahead. So as we take a moment to pray, let's take a moment to let go. Keep what's essential for the journey ahead. And open ourselves to the new that may be ours in our respective churches and in our presbytery. Would you pray with me? Almighty God, as we open our eyes to the reality of your love, as we break the bread and share in the cup, may it be for us Christ's body and blood, received in faith and with thanksgiving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So that's what I'm offering. You have your bread and you have your wine. And you take that piece of bread and you take that cup. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. The gifts of God for the people of God. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
gives us a future, daring us to go into dreams and dangers on a path unknown. We will face tomorrow in the Spirit's power. We will let God change us, for new life starts. Behind us, sins of yesterday, for God's new beginning is a better way. Fear and doubt and habit must not hold us back. God gives hope and insight and the strength we lack. Teach us how to read the signs, how to meet the challenge of our troubled times. Love us into action, stir us into prayer, till we choose God's life and find our future there.
And so, as we continue on our journey, may we remember that we belong to the people of God on the way to the promised end. Through the gift of the Spirit, may God bring us into deeper unity with one another. And may our worship, witness, and service be to God's eternal glory through Jesus Christ the Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace, now and forever. Amen. Let us go in peace.